Bravo.
Okay. I'm going to talk a little about Mandula and how to interact with NATS and little things. A little project that Rose suggested me. Okay, so this is our Monday date. I'm very grateful. I'm working on Trolley as a back office PhD. And these are my information. All the slides are on my GitHub, and also the code running on the devices is in the GitHub as well, so you can check it. So what do? When I'm not at work, I do a lot of things. Open source things like Pops.io. We are 5 people. 3 of them are here. I did the Drupal client from NATS. I also have several Prose extensions for Chrome and these things. And this is my first project with the Internet of Things. So, where did the idea come from? So, I had a little background with the Lua, with the game scripting and these things. It was really common at that age. And 2 years ago, I just started using Lua for backend scripting and data processing because it's quite fast and reliable. And 3 months ago, I created the Lua client for the NATS. And as they offered me, would you like to do something on a presentation or something? I just get this idea with a lot of crowd. And so I took the Internet of Things because it works with a lot of information. So it's good to send messages. And as they are not going to reach like the 8 million messages that they make, I don't know, if you have a lot of sensors. And I'm going to talk a little about the technologies that I've used. The main language is Lua, which has it's been a lot of years in use. It's really you can see it's really small. It has only 20,000 lines of C code. It's portable. You can build it on any platform, and that has a ANSI and C compiler, so you can run it on every operating system. It's also embeddable and accessible, so you can use it over C with JIP, JIP, and you can also make it more fast if you develop in C. And just use it on Lua. So if you have a really critical part of your application, you can write it on C and just integrate it on the Lua, so it will be faster. The technologies, also the Internet of Things part is done with this little board called a Node MCU. They are really cheap. It costs only 7 euros, more or less, each one. So you can go on AliExpress or DirectStream, they sell them, and you can buy 10 or 20, like chips. they run natively Lua, but it's a different type of Lua. It's an implementation, it's called eLua, and it's because it's event driven. Normal Lua is not even driven. It's all sequential. So in this case, you can work with services that return a callback when they are ready. so you can keep your code running and don't wait for something to happen. It's also really easy because it has a special API with a little set of libraries. So you have all the sockets connections ready. You have also a library to work with the board itself. So you can preload the board, you can change the parameters on there. And it's like an Arduino, but cheaper and also faster because you just set it up and it's a good program. You don't need to know the C. And really small, and it has Wi-Fi integrated for 7 years, which is really nice. This version is called Berlin, it's version 3, but there is a lot of versions, so you can check others. I'm using also a Raspberry Pi. That is it's most known, you know, it's used for a lot of student projects and housework. If you like to have a server in the house, or maybe for media playing, these kind of things. But it also integrates a GPL. What it does is it lets you play with an external devices via input-output system. So you can choose any language to program with this GPIO. You can use Python, Lua, C if you want. It's low power consuming and it has a lot of memory and disk. So that this you can replace it or maybe you have 2 or 3 SDs to play with. And the thing is, this hardware can get really addicted, you know? Because you start playing and you don't go to sleep until 4 or 5 in the morning. The other technology is NATS. It's the service running in the middle of everything, handling the messages, and making the system more stable, more work. So, what is that? The important things on NATS is it's really small and portable. That's why you can just put it on a server, or maybe you can put it on another Raspberry. What makes it you can have all your IoT system to be very low consuming. So you don't need a computer to handle all the system. It's also very reliable for production. Of my test, I don't see it broken. And extra, its messaging system can be running on a Raspberry Pi. That's right. Keep that. So, a little about the layout of the system is how does it work. So, it's really simple. All the devices has the UI installed. For Raspberry Pi, I just have to install it through the aggregate system and all the libraries. But for those two, I don't need to install nothing. All the code and the GitHub is the thing you need, nothing else. So they are sending one message per second. In this case, you can configure it to be about 10 messages per second. You want to be more real time. And what NATS does is just publish that message to the subscribers of that channel. So in our case, I will have a database on our server. But it's really simple, it just gets the information from the published message and starts it on a Redis instance so I can read it later on a web page. that's a faster implementation to show you something. But you can also have another system. Maybe you want to put another service that is listening for the temperature, and when the temperature gets high, turn on the air conditioner, or when it gets low, the heater, something like this, or send you an email after that. You know, that's the main useful thing of the Internet of Things. Like the IFTT, you could integrate with IFTT to run something else. So for the hardware, I just told you the node MCU thing. I will have a light sensor, one of them, a noise sensor, and there is the link for the code. And for the Raspberry, I will have the temperature sensor, which I have also the code in there. So this is the light sensor. That's information for the ROM installing the board. If you want to install it, you have all the details there. And it has three light sensors that are variable. You can set different levels of sensitivity. So I have one less sensitive and one more sensitive, so I can track three levels of light, for example. And the noise sensor is the same. It's configurable, so you can have three levels. And the temperature sensor is more analog. You could have a reading precise without meaning of levels. So this one is called is 18B20. It's really, really precise. It has a wide temperature range. So now let's get practical. Let's do something that even I guess funnier. That's why I like. Well, if you